That truly is where the story is. All this rain that fell had to go somewhere. And we're talking often about, and the great things about the rivers in Toronto is there's quite a drop from the Oak Ridges Moraine down to the lakeshore. I mean, for 350 meters. So that water, once it gets in, can cascade, can barrel down those rivers and creeks in the Toronto area. So when you look at what happened on that particular location in the stream flow in the Humber, it was like a freshwater tsunami in a way. All this water came barreling down from the headwaters and right into the Humber River. 90 billion liters of water fell on that, came down the river in that particular moment. You had, in fact, in 1 hour, the water levels rose 6 meters on Humber. You had incredible wave heights of 5 to 7 meters on the Humber River. I mean, that would be a big ocean wave, let alone a river, an urban river for wave. You had, in fact, the current of that water was 48 kilometers per hour. I mean, you couldn't get near it without it sweeping you away and everything in its path. So it was a huge amount of rain in a short period of time and engorged that river, and of course we saw the force of it. Now, I've written about Hurricane Hazel than any other weather event, for good reason. Also, it was, as I say, north of the city, in an area, there's a video clip if you want to see the destruction in the Holland Marsh, north of Toronto, and it was big. I mean, over 3,000 people had been evacuated from their homes. The earthen dike failed, and it was mostly our vegetables and crops up there. That one.
The fact that they stood their ground, and you have that interplay, Storm Agnes, or some people call it Agnes II, it created the issue was. We also, as I say, it was
wasn't just in landslides and fallen trees and blocked roads and filled on area. It was two cars swept off the bridge. And sadly, when you read it, it just brings a tear to your eye, is that these people were within inches of being rescued and then pulled away by the current and didn't make it. I think in many ways, looking back 60 years ago, that few were concerned because this was not hurricane territory. This was something that was foreign to this area. There had been a hurricane, there was a famous hurricane in 1900 called the Galveston Hurricane. Fishing bodies and killed about 100 people. But that was 1900. People had forgotten. We kind of know in weather that 7 years after the event, you're not as worried, you don't have the anxiety after the event. It takes about 7 years of non-activity to kind of get over that kind of thing. So certainly it wasn't something that was common in this area. People went to bed that night thinking that, hey, it was just, you know, a bit of power outages, we flooded basements and intersections, but no big deal. It's been raining since August the 1st. It was this area. This is when the water is the most. This is when you need to refill the groundwater. The streams are the marvelous. So people just didn't think about it at this particular time. And nobody had really any sense of the hydrometeorology of that rain. But there was no authority set up and storing ecological facts. We all saw 6 years ago, in the media, if there was a request on the river, Simpsons and ratings of all the history. My God, it's awesome. How neat. They said, what do you mean our satellite trucks haven't even left yet? So, hey, this weather can seduce us for sure. But also, Trump had changed. It wasn't me. Your parking lots were thinking about. The idea was to pay over and rational and cement and building materials, the more modern you were, and the less dirty you became. So there was this idea to make it a world-class city, and so there was this no hesitation to try and waterproof the city with a cement parking lot or a city, and 50% of Toronto is cement and asphalt. that rain drop becomes a problem. It becomes an issue. Now, I also think fact, I don't know where I am, help me to say, there was a conservation authority that permitted municipalities to form a conservation authority, but it was really took Hazel to inspire pollution and floodplain management. And ruthless as they, some people may say it was, they came in there and they said, okay, you shall not develop the floodplain. That you will, people were bought out. Maybe they weren't given fair market price, but they certainly were bought out. And this area, the rivers of valleys of Toronto, became public parks and for all to enjoy at all seasons. And I think that that is, to me, one of the legacies of Hurricane Hazel. So I think there's 81 people didn't that came from this nasty storm. To where we have today, recognized as one of the best interconnected parkways, park systems in the world in an urban setting. And so, at that time. Now, let me quickly look at the forecast office, because there have been some changes there. And certainly, I often wonder how beavers right now because of the Gonzalo is a hurricane that's about to hit the Maritimes. So I can tell you they're very busy up there. And predation came center in Miami, sharing advice and training and good connection. We also authorities providing the information so people can take that meteorological now, Hazel occur again, most certainly. There's nothing to suggest, even in a more powerful way, these flashy thunderstorms are occurring more often. So, you know, we see certainly that's a possibility. And but I don't think from a environmental destruction, that would be possible. I think that we've got better in place, understand more of the systems, there's no gaps in terms of translating that weather information into hydrologic information. So I think we're certainly better off. And we saw that in July 8th. I mean, a nasty storm, heavy amounts of rain, but no losses, no injuries. And so, you know, Canadians, I think our strength as Canadians is that we are a national nation. We we all seem to do the right thing. We don't have a general country, but we all seem to do your research. A lot of it, we kind of know what to do, we know how to take advantage of. But let me just wind up with one comment or two about hurricanes. And I think that generally the feeling is more anecdotal. Verified is just a suggestion, and we see year in year out evidence of that. There's clearly no individual tropic can be tied to climate change. People try to do that with Katrina. They said, "Oh my gosh, this storm, it came out of our tailpipes and smokestacks." No. It was there. There have been more powerful hurricanes than Katrina that had hit New Orleans. What did change was the land use. That has changed. I think that has even changed more than the weather. The fact that that bayou had been developed with pavement and asphalt.
than the land, believe it or not, that may also be a factor. But it really is inactive. It really is, it's mostly confined to the north.
Driving that are more water temperatures, warmer waters appearing in the northern hemisphere, ocean. I'm too smart to chase storms. I'll leave that to people who kind of know what to do. I've always had sort of like, though, an urge to get one of those and fly through. And then, I mean, they really, you can imagine what it's like flying in those reconnaissance aircraft through that storm wall. There have been occasions where planes have never come up. They've been lost in that. And so it's risky. There is, though, a squadron of hurricane hunters. Three-dimensional characteristics of that, and the information is sent right back into the models, plugged into the models, and so these things are ocean waves by ocean buoys, but by also aircraft, satellites. I mean, the testing of these things, of these storms, has improved dramatically in terms of, you can see them coming days. We're weak about this thing. We're boarding up, and you know, it doesn't really happen so much in our territory because so they normally not as being boarded the character. And torment you and tease you and back up and move back in, hit you twice. So it must be really, from an anxiety point of view, it must be pretty elevated. And but no, I think, you know, as I get older, I don't think I would venture. That's not in my bucket list.
Any other questions?
You know, into the eye, the roughest part of the hurricane, because that's really, they have a pretty good, and that's where really all of the energy is. That's where the convective processes are taking place, and they can plug that into, and then their models will be able to look at the other weather systems and the size of it and factor that in. So it really is flying into that eye. Can you imagine, I think if you were flying there, you'd probably go to the bathroom and get ready for the next half hour when you would fly into that eye wall. So really, that's they really concentrate, and they would do it several times, several elevations, and several altitudes.
As far as Leeward Island.
Oh, the distance.
Yeah.
Oh, I see. I know the one air base is in New Orleans. But they really can go quite a distance, and they wouldn't just tip any kind of storm to go into. It would be one where it was a little bit more threatening about into it and to monitor the conditions inside that.
Yes.
All right, thank you. Really enjoyed the talk and the presentation of facts, and also your enthusiastic way in the end. I'm thinking more of Toronto. You were making compliments in terms of what has been learned about Hurricane Hazel. That's my general sense, that they're, you know, the whole layout of the city, getting people out of the floodplain, all those things. And that Don Valley Parkway.
statistics of weather, that storms seem to be stormier, you see, a little bit more intense. They seem to last a little longer. And that's having an impact. That's why we're seeing things like Don Valley is it's flooded every time there seems to be a major rain event. My hope is that people are paying attention to that. I think certainly in the bureaucracy of Toronto, they are, whether it's being translated up the pipe to people willing to do something about it is another issue. But I certainly know the conservation authorities people, the engineers, the city planners are well aware and clearly are trying to do things not to prevent it. I mean, this is the thing about climate or weather. You can't, all the blowing you do doesn't stop that storm from coming your way. But by planning and doing things differently and accepting it and realizing that that event is going to come, then you can cushion the blow. You can prevent it from becoming a disaster. The hazard is going to be there, but you can not just sort of grin and bear it and say, well, you know, you might as well just accept it, it's going to come. No. You can do things differently in a 25-cent way and also a multi-million dollar way to cushion that kind of blow. And I think it's a matter of making people aware of the fact that the weather is changing and that it's not just the same old, same old. I often preach the fact that don't do what your grandparents did or your teachers told you to do because the situation has changed.
Hey, Seth, just a small amount to that.
Actually, no, there's a couple of other people.
Just to build on? Just to build on? No,
the gentleman at the back, I think there's somebody at the back here had their hand up next.
Yeah, you had an image, I think you described as was that a radar image or was it?
No, it wasn't Hazel. I'm sure it wasn't Hazel. There were no satellites came about 6 to 10 years later. So I apologize for that. And I should have made that point at the beginning that not all of these slides are connected. I'm showing slides to create a mood in terms of hurricanes and eyes and things like that. But no, there were no shots of the Hazel storm itself.
Okay, and one more question is the gentleman.
As you mentioned earlier, the conservation authorities ordered to 100-year storm flood control line for some years, probably since Hazel, that correct you?
I think it is.
Yes, and now they're looking at 200 to 300 years.
Right.
Do you think that is reasonable, or is 100 years kind of a reasonable probability for protecting the property?
A little bit more often in the suburban areas than you do in the downtown. So, you know, I know the answer to that. I think that if the 300-year storm is being used as a criteria, that's being implemented, maybe another issue. Maybe the design storm, but maybe they're taking something less than that.
Beautiful question. Sandy Bedecki did our Hurricane Hazel talk last year and works with Dave at Environment Canada. So, on Sandy.
The design storms aren't for 100 years.
They're not for 100?
No, they're 25.
They're 25, okay. Doesn't it vary though, Sandy, depending upon the, whether it be a built-up area?
Well, mostly the cities in the 25-year storms, they don't want to spend that kind of money for outside the Toronto area or outside the big city. But the design storms are based on 25 because of the cost. Okay. Now, if you have a 50-year, then the insurance is a little bit more much.
I'll end the questions now because we're getting a bit late, and I will. I'd like to thank Dave very much. Interesting form. I think everybody was spellbound for the entire talk, which was wonderful. And I'm going to invite everybody to stay after to come across into the Humber Room across the hall and have coffee tea. We've got information on membership with Heritage York. And if you want to focus on any future Heritage Talk, you should talk to all the house. So I also Yeah, that's it. Cookies and coffee and tea. Thank you all very much.